I'm confident that the Earth revolves around the Sun and not the other way around. Who else in this room thinks the same way? Let's show a raise of hands. Okay, that's pretty much all of you. I'm equally confident that keeping the human diet practically void of animals is the right thing to do. It was not always so, though. Just as there was a time when people tried to undermine the sun-centered view of the solar system, there was a time when I didn't quite like vegetarians. At best, I thought vegetarians were tolerable, and at worst, they were just plain annoying. And it is strange that this was my impression of vegetarians, since until recently, I've only known one person who was a vegetarian, one person who decided not to eat animals. And she was fun and not annoying at all. So I wondered why she was a vegetarian. And it turned out that in the country where she is from, animals raised for food have to endure horrid conditions and suffering. So I kind of understood why she was a vegetarian, but it felt strangely comforting that I did not have to resort to any such measures, since where I come from, animals are treated nicely. Also, I had heard one time on the radio that domesticated animals could not survive without us, just as we could not survive without them. From that perspective, the human-animal relationship was a win-win situation. However, since about 5 years ago, I have reduced my amount of animal intake to such an extent that today it is practically zero. Now, why would I do that? Well, inspection shows that frequently animals raised for food have to endure horrid conditions and suffering, not just in my friend's country, but in every country across the globe. And there is more. Raising animals for food is destructive to the environment, and the leading cause of human death are diseases which are associated with a poor diet rich in animal products. So the human-animal relationship is not a win-win situation. It is a lose-lose-lose situation. We are losing, the animals are losing, and the environment is losing. These are the three pillars advocating the shift from an animal-based diet towards a plant-based diet. The first pillar, human health. Current research strongly suggests that if humans would shift towards a plant-based diet, they would live longer, and healthcare systems across the globe could be streamlined. This is related to reduction in deadly, difficult, and expensive diseases, such as heart disease, diabetes, and certain forms of cancer. Given the likelihood of a better health on a plant-based diet, it is an option that people should be encouraged to exercise more often. Compared to eating animals, eating plants is not only more likely to be more healthy, it also has a much stronger ethical standpoint, which brings us to the center pillar, the animals. The vast majority of animals raised for food reside on factory farms. And every single year, we kill over 60 billion land animals. Out of these 60 billion land animals, 1.3 billion are pigs. So, to sustain the demand for pig-eating humans, these killings need to be maintained. And to maintain these killings, the first line of business is to make sure that the pigs are giving birth to all the piglets that we kill every year. So through the centuries, female pigs or sows have been bred and selected to be able to give birth to as many offspring as possible. And today, each sow gives birth to 10 to 12 piglets 2 times a year. The days prior to giving birth and during lactation, the sow is kept in a closed metal enclosure called a gestation crate. While in the gestation crate, the sow cannot move about, not even turn around, let alone make any meaningful contacts with her piglets. Soon after birth, the testicles of male piglets are removed, allegedly to make their meat smell better when it is cooked. And to avoid biting and being bitten, some piglets have the tails and selected teeth removed as well. With certainty, regardless of the conditions until then, when the piglets are around 3 weeks old, they are removed from the presence of the mother forever. During the rest of their short lives, they're kept in crowded places to be fed and to grow, with thousands of their kin who are all destined for the same senseless fate. Meanwhile, their mother is being prepared for her next pregnancy session. To keep the sows constantly pregnant, they are impregnated through artificial insemination performed by humans. The pig semen is also collected by human professional masturbators. You can look up pig semen collection on YouTube if you're interested. So even though pigs give birth to offsprings all the time, they never have sex. And I guess most of us appreciate that pigs are sentient beings that can feel pleasure and pain often in similar ways that we humans do. Thus it seems inconsistent that losing an offspring, which is arguably the most painful experience humans have to endure, is an experience that we carelessly inflict upon pigs all the time. Most pigs never breathe fresh air or walk under the bare blue sky. And the only time they might see a glimpse of the sun is when they're in the back of a truck being transported for slaughter. What I have said here about pigs can without much difficulty be adapted to fit the lives of other domesticated animals such as chickens or cows. The third pillar, the environment. The staggering amount of animals we raise for food is having some dire consequences for the environment. Consequences that were perhaps unforeseen at the time, but have become so blatantly obvious at the present. To put things in context, let's go 12,000 years back in time. 12,000 years ago, there were no domesticated animals, and the combined weight of all large land animals was around 300 million tons, out of which human represented 1%. Today, the total combined weight of all large land animals is almost 1,500 million tons, 5 times the amount it was 12,000 years ago. Out of these 1,500 million tons, more than 1,100 are domesticated animals. More than 300 are humans, and wild animals represent only around 30 million tons. So we used to be 1% out of 300 million, but today, along with the domesticated animals, we are 98% out of 1,500 million. That's a huge difference in a very short time. So with this picture in mind, three things emerge. Number one, our domesticated animals eat a lot of food. How come we are able to feed 1,100 million tons of animals, but we cannot prevent 10 million people to die from dying from malnutrition every year? How come there are more people who die from eating too much than there are people who die from eating too little? Number two, our domesticated animals take up a lot of space. To make space for our animals and the food we grow for them, we cut down rainforest. And when we cut down the rainforest, we're not only destroying the planet's defenses against carbon dioxide, but we're also destroying the habitats of wild species and driving them extinct. The main driver for species extinction is rainforest destruction. And the main driver for rainforest destruction is animal agriculture, mainly cattle production. Number three, our domesticated animals release a lot of waste. All these animals shit, piss, fart, and burp. And while all is bad for the environment, it is the burp that is having the most damaging effect. When ruminant animals, like cattle and sheep, burp, they release methane. And apparently, they burp a lot. And methane is a greenhouse gas that is much more potent at heating the atmosphere than ever carbon dioxide. Mainly because of ruminant animals, the global release of greenhouse gases from animal agriculture is so enormous that it is greater than for the whole transportation sector combined. Now, reflecting upon these pillars may leave some of you with the idea that there's something wrong with the human species. That of all the species, it is the absolute worst. And given the terms we set for the survival of billions of animals, it's not that hard to lose faith in humanity. And it is not just how we treat non-human animals that can deter us from a glimpse of hope. We are also dealing with wars, refugee crisis, climate change, terrorists, nuclear threat, world hunger, and various forms of discrimination. There are parts on Earth where women have little or no control over their lives or their bodies, and there are parts on Earth where people are being persecuted because they do not love or have sex in an orthodox way. And every single year, 6 million children die before they reach the age of 5. So, with this grim picture in mind, it seems reasonable to ask, will the human species ever make an effort to change from an animal-based diet towards a plant-based diet? Do we even have what it takes to make such a shift? Well, I believe the answer is a resounding yes, and let me tell you why. It's mainly because of two things. First, despite all our faults, human beings have a great capacity for compassion, and our compassion has been increasing, and it continues to increase. Also, we have made some meaningful impact in the defense of animals. So, many of the bad things humans do is blown out of proportion. Human history clearly shows that we are much more peaceful and less violent than we used to be. There used to be a time when encounters between two human tribes burst out in violent conflict. We have come a long way since. Today, we are over 7 billion human beings living in relative harmony. Never before has there been so few wars. And despite the media hype, the terrorist threat is relatively minuscule. Torture used to be a display for people's entertainment. The death penalty has been abolished in many countries. Slavery has been outlawed. And slowly but surely since then, discrimination based on race is no longer considered defensible. The rights and empowerment of women have seen a very positive and dramatic effect over the last century or two. And the rights of homosexuals is improving. Notably, homosexuality was decriminalized in the United Kingdom only in 1982. A further testament to our altruistic behavior can be seen in how we donate money to help people who live in extreme poverty. People we do not know and will never know. Such altruistic behavior seems impossible in other species. And while it is true that 6 million children die every year before they reach the age of 5, it was only 30 years ago when this number was 12 million. Improvement in other poverty-related areas is evident as well. So it seems irrefutable that human beings have a great capacity for compassion and that our compassion is increasing. And that gives us a good reason to be optimistic that we can make the shift from an animal-based diet towards a plant-based diet. Also, we have made some meaningful impact in the defense of animals. Many countries now have laws that govern animals where there used to be none. Using these laws, conditions for animals have improved, perhaps most notably in the European Union. But also, big American food companies have improved the conditions for their animals, not because they were told to do so by the government, but rather due to popular demand from their consumers. Arguably, these efforts are not enough, but they do show, when it comes to animal suffering, that people are aware and that they do care. Another impact in the defense of animals is the fact that more and more people are deciding, for whatever reason, to forego animal products in their daily lives. With an increasing demand for animal-based products, restaurants, supermarkets, entrepreneurs are responding with an increase in supply and variety, which in turn makes it even easier for people to accept and choose a plant-based option. Despite these positive things, the fact remains that factory farming is one of the greatest problems facing the human race, a problem of such proportion that it affects the entire biosphere of the planet. That is why it is genuinely important that as many people as possible participate in the shift towards a plant-based diet. If we take a look at the atrocities that we have so successfully and often proudly eradicated from our civilized societies, such as torture, slavery, death penalty, and discrimination, and then look at what is happening with the animals we eat, it does not take too much effort of our imagination to appreciate that it is with the animals we eat where torture takes place, where slavery prevails. At its very essence, it is discrimination. Fellow human beings, it is high time that we embrace non-human animals within our expanding moral circle. It will bring unprecedented benefits to humans and other animals alike for generations to come.